here we go. How far that vine travels out through the woods. How they get laced that far? Isn't that amazing? I mean, I can see it growing vertically, but to grow that far horizontally across the woods and through the trees. Okay, I think I'm going to walk up this way and then out to the right. See some leans out there. This doesn't look natural. That was just stuck in the ground. To me here, a few things. Like that dead limb right there, doesn't have any bark on it. All been skinned off, or that's how old it is, somehow into that vine. I got the vine looped around it. I don't know how that could happen without that piece being shoved up through that loop. Anyway, look at these things all laid up here. Leaned up against that little tree. Will you notice the difference in those little dead things and the tree it's in? The little tree it's in is alive. They are of a different time period. Those things laid on the ground so long I can see moss growing on them and all the bark is gone. And yet they got up off of the ground somehow and laid up through there like that. To me, that's too unusual to have happened, like, without assistance. Look at these things. Yep. Just looks unnatural to me. But before it gets dark, I do want to take a walk out in this other direction and then down and then back to the car. Logs laid around here. Looks like they've been here for a long time. Bark's off of them too. But there's a root ball on one. It didn't grow right there. Now how did that get through the woods? Unless something moved it. Yeah. There's two more bent over. Tree bends. Right there. And a smaller one over there. I really don't suppose that they were growing nice and straight and strong and then suddenly decided to bend like that by themselves. There's two more bent over. Tree bends. Thank you. like we got some little feet bending them over too. I don't think that thing grew up there and then suddenly decided to just wrap on down to the ground like that. I think it had help somehow. I just came from that way. I'd love to see something move on the ridge. I just walked past that without looking and leaned my hand up against it and realized, what's that thing doing up in the air? Look how old that is. Rotten. But it's on that limb right there and under that one. And let me see, did it grow there? Nope. Somebody or something wants it there, though. I don't think it got up there by itself. Getting darker still. I really don't know how these are going to turn out until I get home to edit them. Hate to be walking around taking videos of the dark. I hope the camera works a little better than that. Big old beech tree right there. There sure are a lot of these vines in here that seem to want to transverse in a horizontal direction through the woods. Now look at that one there. Looks like it got caught on that little beech sapling, and the sapling grew and raised a vine up off the ground or something there. See how it's caught over that limb? I don't know what the heck we got here. Doing that wrong. And then right back down into the ground. you can walk this trail for miles back through those woods, staying on the ridges and dropping down into the valleys. I was up much higher on the ridge one time, way up there near the crowns in the oak trees that still have the leaves on them, you can see against the sky. And I looked across this way, and over there on the ridge, you can see it from up that way. Well, over there on the ridge was a installation that looked like a HAARP array. If you're familiar with that, had maybe 3 or 4 dozen tall antennae. Very interesting. It was, shocked me. The only thing, you know, that's considered something new in all these conspiracy theory websites and stuff, as a HAARP array working on the weather, changing the weather and causing good weather in some places and hurricanes and storms in the other. Well, when I was in the Army Transportation hauling supplies during typhoons that disabled the rest of the island, and they would send 13 of us out to keep the outpost going, there was a HAARP array there, and that was in 1967. And that was the same year that I pulled into Kadena Air Base with a mobile guided missile guidance system on the back of my deuce and a half, and had them to shuttle me out of there real quick, act like they didn't want to receive it after ordering the thing and me hauling it all that way. And I, down on the end of the runway, there was an SR-71 Blackbird turning around. It looked like something that's still futuristic. I never seen anything like that before. But that was highly top secret, and they denied the thing even existed. It has been shot at 5 times by different nations, one of them being North Korea, and their missiles don't go fast enough to catch it, and they don't go high enough. It has never been hit. It's painted black because it flies against a black sky even in a daytime. It flies up beyond the envelope of Earth's atmosphere, and it goes Mach 3 plus. They won't tell you how much plus, but it goes 3 times as fast as the speed of sound. Anyway, one day I was here and I looked over there from a higher vantage point, and off to my right this way, this is recent stuff put up here by Chevron and the other oil companies, but up there where you can't see unless you're higher on this side, and if you do get higher, then you can see, it looks like a big field of vertical antenna, and it looks just like the HAARP array that I saw on Okinawa. And you can even Google the one up in Alaska and see a picture of it yourself. They've shown quite a few of those now. Well, I've got to start down that way through that opening. My 2 sons used to walk down through this game lands right away about 12:30, 1 o'clock in the morning, after having called gray foxes in on that right away right there. I mean, it gets, some of those nights get pitch dark. They just suck up the light beams from your mag light or whatever you got. Other nights are moonlight and lit up with the stars a good bit, and I don't care for them because you need it to be really dark so things can't see, and then when you turn your light on, it's like a blanket of light in front of you. If you can hide behind it, nothing can see you. Anyway, we had more luck on a really dark night. There is a treetop. And it's upside down in another tree. But if you keep looking, you'll see where it came from. See the bigger diameter tree behind it that it's leaning toward? The top of it is missing. I would say that broke off up there and it tumbled over, and you know, when it broke off, it swung down around and hit them and then dropped off, and there's where she lays. The wind. I don't think lightning did that one. Probably the wind testing it in a weak spot. A fresh break. Little limb there on an oak tree. Come from up there. Pretty high. I'll break that off. One time my son and I, Brian, was digging ginseng, and it was getting dark, darker than this. And of course the foliage was on the trees at that time, so it was much darker than this in the woods. But we could look up toward the top of the hill and see the silhouette of the sky. I mean, we knew the sun had gone down below the horizon. And wouldn't be very long at all, too. It would be really black. So, as we were stepping out, we had like, I'd say 400 yards to go yet. And we was walking through the woods trying to get out into the field or onto the road where we could see. Because nobody likes running into things. And guess what? We come across a mound of dirt in the woods that had four-pronged ginseng growing all over it. Must have been about 40 of them there. Boy, were they nice and healthy. And we decided to dig them and leave the twos and the threes. And it just got progressively darker as we were digging, trying to dig real fast so we wouldn't be in total blackness. And as we were digging it, unbeknownst to us, above us, up the hillside a little ways, was a flock of turkeys landing in a big old dead tree, getting ready to roost for the night. And that old limb just wouldn't hold. About 15 turkeys tried to sit on that one limb, and all the rest of them was scattered around the crown of the tree. But that one limb, way up high, come crashing down out of there. You ought to have seen me and Brian. You'd think we had springs in our feet. I mean, we just jumped straight up in the air. It made a heck of a noise. And there was still enough of the action left for us when we looked up to see them beating their wings and trying to get airborne. And the limb was falling down through there. That's when we realized what had happened. And I think all of the rest of them took off out of the tree too, keeping herself like flying in place, just flapping their wings and staying there until they all settled back down and found a limb that would support all of them on that same tree. Yeah, that was something. About ginseng, I'd like to mention something to you a little bit. I don't blame the states for trying to manage the ginseng. I think most states have adopted the National Forest Service's policy, and I can see why they did it. But in our area, well, we used to benefit the ginseng a whole lot more than just it would have been naturally if we hadn't have been there. You see, in nature, there's a lot of approaches toward preservation of the species, and One of them is to like really overproduce seeds, like dandelions and such, because they are so vulnerable to birds eating them, you know, to be foraged upon and such, that it's not just prevalent in plants but also in animals, that many of them overproduce an abundance of young in such great numbers, especially like the little turtles and some aquatic life from fish and things, that even though the vast majority of them get eaten and perpetuates the life of those life forms that are preying on them, even though a lot of things eat them, they arrive into this world in such vast numbers from the eggs that are laid or deposited that there's plenty enough that do survive that even expands the species in the area. Well, that's the way it is with ginseng. They have probably, oh, maybe 30, 35 berries on a pod, and some even bigger, up to around 50 or 60. And they just fall off right there where that plant is. Now, usually when you find ginseng, you find more than one. They grow in patches. So as soon as they fall down on the ground and start growing, they are in competition with the other ginseng plants that are growing in that patch. And so, I don't know, I'm just taking a guess, maybe between 2 to 4 of the maybe 30 seeds that fall on the ground actually germinate, take root, fell, you know, serendipitously into a proper place where the nutrients are good and enough warmth and soil that it, maybe 4 or 5 of them might catch out of the 30. But not if we hunted there. My children, my daughters, and my sons would go with me every year, and we would gather up enough ginseng out of the Pennsylvania forests to rent a beach house for a week in the Outer Banks of North Carolina. But I'll tell you what, you go back, you know, we would go back to the same woods. I had a big circuit I had grown up. We would go back maybe 10 years. 10 years later, and in 10 years' time, there would be 4-prongers everywhere. Not only did they sprout out and go and grow into 2-prongers and 3 and then 4, I'm talking about the tops of the plants now, the forks, but there's a whole lot more where we had passed through 10 years earlier, because before we dug any ginseng, we would take the berries off, and instead of just scattering them, we would plant them under about a half an inch to an inch of soil or leaves and debris in the woods scattered far enough apart so that they could grow easily without competition from each other. And I've walked into the woods where we've been before, but there was ginseng throughout the woods after about 8 or 10 years. So, anyway, everybody didn't do that. A lot of people just dug it. And they didn't seem to care if they raped the land or not, but we did. But we have since quit. None of my children, nor do I, hunt it any longer, because of the laws that the state put out kind of prohibits you from doing it that way. So the old woods where I used to hunt, all those places are on their own now, and I'll bet you there's not as much sang. Well, since we did that, and people really don't know what it is, and they put the laws on it the way they have, so that you're allowed to start hunting ginseng when it has already started dying. Since we were there and got a lot of it going, together that might have worked out all right. But I'm getting too old to hunt it anymore. And I think now, wow, it is too dark to see anything in the woods. So I might as well go. I heard my cell phone go off, so I think Viv might be texting me to see if I'm all right. And there is the old escape, peeping up over the rise. I just heard something back there. Yelling. Huh. Okay. We're coming.